गुड मॉर्निंग चिल्ड्रन, इन टूडेज क्लास वी विल डिस्कस अबाउट चैप्टर नंबर 4, अल्टरनेटिव सेंटर्स ऑफ पावर। इन दिस टॉपिक वी हैड ऑलरेडी डिस्कस अबाउट यूरोपियन यूनियन एंड एशिया। दीज आर द टू मेजर रीजनल ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस of the world nowadays. In today's class we will discuss about China, that is the major superpower nowadays after the disintegration of USSR. Please check this map of China. You can observe the political boundaries of China with the different countries like Mongolia, Russia, Kazakhstan, India, Myanmar, Vietnam and Laos. What is special about China? That from the last 50 years, it has changed its economy, its political structure to get the different development stages. So China, the Soviet model and the failure of Soviet model and the adaptation of capitalist model after 1978. In this particular slide, we will discuss about all these things. Actually, the strength of China is its economy with some other factors like the population, the landmass, resources, regional location and political influence. These things adds to its power in sufficient ways. We have to understand that China is having the largest population in the world, and it has enormous mineral and other resources with an effective regional location in Asia. So these things increase the political influence of China. Now come to the point, People's Republic of China in 1949. China, following the communist revolution under the leadership of Mao Zedong with the Cultural Revolution, its economy was based on the Soviet model, which was first adopted by USSR after the 1917 Russian Revolution. What were the efforts of the government to check out the economical development? They had adopted a closed economy to save their own industries and other economical sectors from the stiff competition at that time. They create a state-owned heavy industrial sector from the capital accumulated from agriculture so that they can develop the heavy industries in China. Then some type of short of foreign exchange that it needed in order to buy technology and goods on the world market. Then China decided to substitute imports by domestic goods, and most of the countries in the world to get the economical development, they always try to substitute imports with their domestic produced goods. Then what were the effects of the Soviet model? Soviet model established the foundations of an industrial economy on a scale that did not exist before. Then employment and social welfare was assured to all the citizens living in China. China moved ahead of most developing countries in educating its citizens and ensuring better health for them. The economy also grew at a respectable rate of 5 to 6% per annum. But an annual growth of 2 to 3% in population meant that economic growth was insufficient to meet the needs of a growing population. So we have to understand that the demographic features or the too much pressure of the population can create so many problems for the economic development. Agricultural production was not sufficient to generate a surplus for industry. And these types of problems we had already discussed in the chapter, the disintegration of USSR. Now come to the topic, the crisis of state-controlled economy. In the USSR, which we had already discussed in chapter 2, a similar crisis was to face China too. Its industrial production was not growing fast enough, then international trade was minimal and per capita income was very low. That's why the standard of living was quite poor. And in other facilities also, China was unable to get the economic growth which they want. What were the changes after 1970 in economical sectors of China? China ended its political and economic isolation with the establishment of relations with the United States in 1972. Four modernizations. Please remember, four modernizations: the agriculture sector, the industrial sector, science and technology, and military in 1973 to 1978. It was the agenda. The then leader Deng Xiaoping announced the open door policy and economic reforms in China. So now you have to understand that a communist country ready to adopt the capitalist reforms in their country. The policy was to generate higher productivity by investments of capital and technology from abroad. So, with the help of these points, you can easily understand that a communist country is going to adopt the all type of capitalist economy model and their features. And what is unique about the China that they had adopted their own path in introducing a market economy. They did not go for shock therapy, but opened their economy step by step. And we all know that because of the shock therapy, the entire USSR and its republics had to face a lot of problems after 1988-89. The privatization of agriculture in China in 1982 was followed by the privatization of industry in 1998. Trade barriers were eliminated only in special economic zones where foreign investors could set up enterprises. In China, the state played and continues to play a central role in setting up a market economy. What is unique about this? That in the capitalist economies like USA, the government not controlled the economic sector. But here we can see that the Chinese government was have an effective influence on the economical activities. The new economic policies helped the Chinese economy to break from stagnation. With the help of privatization, market economy, and other things, they had opened their economy. Privatization of agriculture led to a remarkable rise in agricultural production and rural incomes. High personal savings in the rural economy lead to an exponential growth in rural industry. Growth in terms of foreign trade, investments, etc. So their economy was quite impressive. Then the next step was China's accession to the WTO in 2001. They had integration into the world economy and shaped the future world economic order. And if you can observe, in 2020, the Chinese economy is world's largest economy, one of the largest economies. They had got the economic development and prosperity of their people. China becomes a major economic power after 1980s. Their political and diplomatic influences with the help of veto power in United Nations Security Council creates more influence in the world politics. The problems and consequences which the Chinese economy and China had to face are, while the Chinese economy has improved dramatically, not everyone in China has received the benefits of the reforms. And it's quite complicated that whenever they have got a huge amount of wealth and all other things, but it was not in the benefits of all the people. Unemployment has risen in China, with nearly 100 million people looking for jobs. Female employment and condition of work are as bad as in Europe of the 18th and 19th centuries. Environmental degradation and corruption have increased, besides a rise in economic inequality between rural and urban residents and coastal and inland provinces. So these were some of the things they had to face. However, regionally and globally, China has become an economic power to reckon with. The integration of China's economy and the interdependencies that this has created has enabled China to have considerable influences with its trade partners. Hence, its outstanding issues with Japan, the US, ASEAN and Russia have been tempered by economic considerations. And if you have observed in this COVID-19 situation, in 2020, here again some of the problems occurred in between the communist capitalist economies, and on the other hand there are the capitalist economies of US, Japan and all. China hopes to resolve its differences with Taiwan, which it regards as a renegade province, by integrating it closely into its economy. Fears of China's rise have also been mitigated by its contributions to the stability of the Asian economies after the 1997 financial crisis. It's more outward looking investments and aid policies in Latin America and Africa are increasingly projecting it as a global player on the side of developing economies. So these are some of the points by which we can understand the Chinese economy and its role exactly after the 1980s reforms. Now come to the point on India-China relations. No direct connections and relations before British trade of tea and opium were there between India and China. There were some pilgrims who had visited India in the ancient period. In the medieval period, there were some visitors from China who had visited India, but there were not direct relations between the two countries. The two countries were connected after the tea trade, or we can say triangular tea trade, between India, China and Britain. So anyhow, so what were the relations between India and China from 1947 to 1962? India gives recognition to China in United Nations Organization. Then the leaders of the two countries had signed the Panch Sheel in 1954. After that, the slogan of Hindi Chini Bhai Bhai was popularized. Issue of Dalai Lama creates some problems in between these two countries, and Tibet War in 1962. And because of that, the two countries were engaged in direct confrontations in the boundaries. And basically the problems were related to Aksai Chin and Ladakh. From 1962 to 1976, there were not direct diplomatic relations between India and China. From 1976 to 1998, some initiated to resolve border disputes during Janata Party government and Rajiv Gandhi government, but they were not successful. After 1998 till today, after the nuclear test done by India and help to Pakistan and favors Pakistan on many issues by China, create some problems in smooth relations between India and China. But the bilateral trade between the two countries is increased exactly after the new economic policy adopted by India in 1991. Nowadays, mostly economic relations are there between India and China. China opposes India's efforts of permanent membership and in United Nations Security Council. And as a student of political science, we have to understand that there are a lot of border issues are still create a problem. And in 2020, we can observe some border conflict with China. And the efforts of both the countries, we can observe in the different news channels. So I hope today's topic related to China is understood to everyone. Today we had discussed the Chinese economy from 1945 to 2020. Some problems due to the communist system. Then the adaptation of the new capitalist market economy in China, the impacts of market economy in China, and the political and diplomatic relations between India and China we had discussed today. So thank you very much, everyone.